Jack 1, 2.
Just keep going.
are so glad that you joined us today. We pray that you are doing well as all of us continue. It's such a blessing to have one another as we walk this journey together. Amen? Amen. Well, today we begin a new series entitled One Another. And specifically, our theme today is to love one another. Last Sunday was a joyous Easter celebration of the depth of Christ's love for us. The cost of it was infinite. It cost the suffering and death of the Son of God. The strength of his love was so great that he overcame the obstacle to in our own ungodliness and unworthiness. The benefits of his love are as great as everything God owns in the universe. Nothing will separate us from him, and nothing good will be kept from us by him. We are his heirs. Nobody took his life from him. He laid it down on his own accord. Christ loves you more than you can comprehend. Ephesians 3, 17 through 19 tells us this. May you be rooted and grounded in love and thus be able to comprehend with all the saints how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. And to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. The more we understand and accept God's love for us, the more we desire to love others as we have been loved. As we begin our worship today, we focus on God's love as we read his word together. We're going to join together and read from John chapter 4, verse 7, and then 9 through 10, and then finish with verse 19. And so we're going to read that together. Here we go. Let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. We love because he first loved us. We give you thanks, Lord God, for your word. Would you join me as we bow for a moment of prayer as we begin? Loving Savior, we gather in your name and we rest in your love. While we were yet sinners, you died for our sins and made it possible for us to be in your presence. You have cleansed us and have called us to a holy life. We worship you in spirit and in truth. We bow before you and we cry, Holy, holy, holy are you, O Lord. We lift our praise to you, for you alone are worthy. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are here touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. I worship you. You are here turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here.
Oh, working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working.
We celebrate who you are this morning. We are so grateful. We also take joy in who we are in you, Lord. As we gather into this time and we lift up our praise and our worship, Lord, we proclaim that we are yours and that we are amazingly perfected through the work of the cross. You died for us even yet when we were sinners, Lord. And we are so grateful that we have that assurance. Blessed assurance, Lord, Jesus is mine. We lift up our praise this morning.
Of mercy, whisper. perfect submission. All is at rest. I am my Savior, am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking up. In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe. So let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing, and in our weakness and temptations, we believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. Let the lost be found, let the dead be raised, and the hearing. He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion.
Lord, we give you thanks for your presence as we rest in your love, as we rest in your presence this morning, as we lift our praise, as we lift our worship, Lord, we celebrate your love. We love because we have been loved. We pray all these praises and blessings, and we lift them up in your holy name, the name of Jesus. Amen.
Well, good morning, everyone. We are so glad that you're joining us here online. I'm going to encourage you now to open up your Bibles to John chapter 13. We're going to be looking at verses 34 and 35 today. Over these last few weeks, I have seen so many in our congregation shower love on one another. I've been inspired and lifted up by the care and support that you have shown to one another and all of those within our community. See, the admiration that I have for you, brothers and sisters of Christ at ECOB, is deep. And seeing how you have followed Christ in your lives, even when we are in these unique times, is leaving a legacy for so many. Last week, I talked a little bit about how every Sunday, that every day is not just one day, but Resurrection Day is every day. And while, yes, we celebrate the moment that Jesus left the grave, each day we will have encounters with Jesus that show us a hope that sustain us in the valley. Now, this past week, on Thursday, we had our love feast. It's called Maundy Thursday, and this is typically a moment that I really cherish and look forward to here at ECOB. It's a time that in the past that we have gathered around tables for dinner, talking with one another, loving on each other, caring for one another. The table does that, right? I mean, at the table, as we learned a few weeks ago, it's the place of hope. It's a place of peace. It's a place of love, and it's a place of welcome. Love Feast is typically a space where we gather as those who love Jesus to recreate the Last Supper he had with his disciples before his crucifixion. But this year, we were apart, and we still had that time together. Through Zoom, we used breakout rooms to eat together with one another, sharing with one another from the safety of our own homes. We spent time in study as Ryan led us in a meditation. We prayed a prayer of self-examination, and then Kim led us into this time where we went back into our groups, and our deacons led us as we prayed for one another and encouraged one another and lifted one another up. We participated in communion, each person, each family bringing their own unique bread and cup with the elements together. And finally, we spoke a covenant together, one that says that we will encourage one another and lift one another up, that we will walk with each other no matter what. And finally, friends, we had a time at the very end where people just lingered and they talked with one another, and they said, oh, it's so good to see you. I love you. It's great. And friends, I had a wonderful time at that love feast. It was one of my favorite love feasts. But this feast, which is biblically centered and one that our heritage as brethren are passionate about, we had over 100 people from 50 different families participating, from Pennsylvania to Maryland to Puerto Rico even. And after our time together was done, I received a number of phone calls and emails and texts sharing that so many felt the sense of love in that space, even though we were not together in the same room. An appreciation for gathering together in the body in this way, a wonderful opportunity to pray for and encourage each other. The idea of the love feast took on a whole new meaning this year on Maundy Thursday. However, the idea of being with one another in Christian love was not diminished. In fact, I believe it was enhanced and it was expanded and it was exponentially more powerful than ever before. Friends, I believe that when love permeates all we do, God is honored, and in turn, we are blessed. In the beginning of the year, we focused on our own hearts as we were going through the reconstruction of the soul, if you remember that series. And then we talked about what it means to invite others to the table. But you know what? God's awesome. God gave us a spirit detour. And when the world went a different direction, we flowed along with the Spirit in that way. And we talked about the peace and the promise and the power of God. And so as we enter into this new series called One Another, I encourage you to be thinking of those in your circles, about how you treat one another and disciples, and as you follow Jesus along this journey. Be attentive to your spirit at this time. Be attentive on how you connect with others who walk with you in faith and seek out God's call and will in your life. Now, specifically today, as I started out this message, we're going to talk about how we are to love one another. In our scripture from John 13, Jesus shares this last evening with his disciples before he's crucified. And they're together in the upper room, and Jesus began the evening by washing the disciples' feet, right? Teaching them humility and servanthood. And while they are eating, Jesus says, listen, one of you are going to betray me. And during the resulting questions and turmoil, Judas kind of quietly leaves the room. And Jesus begins to talk about what it means to be his disciple. In his last instructions, he says, if you will, let me give you a new command. Love one another. In the same way that I have loved you, love one another. I mean, this is how everyone will recognize that you are my disciples, when they see the love that you have for each other. Did you hear how Jesus starts these words? Let me give you a new command. Loving one another is not a new command. I mean, I've been hearing that ever since I was a little kid. I mean, haven't you? I mean, in fact, it's an old command. It's an Old Testament command. Back in Leviticus 19:18, it says, love your neighbor as yourself, right? I mean, that scripture dates more than 1,000 years before Jesus was even born. I mean, how can he say that this is something new? What makes this command new is that we are being commanded to love people the way that Jesus loves people. Now, to understand what that means, we have to get back to kind of the original language of the New Testament. See, in the Greek language, there are more than 13 words that we translate as love. One of those words, philia, is brotherly love, and that's the kind of love that we have for one another, right? There are other words that are Greek that are translated as loved, and one that's actually not found in the Bible called storge. It's familial love. It's the kind of love that a mother has for a child. And eros, which we know is kind of that ooh-ha-ha, the romantic love, and it's the passionate love that couple have for one another. And then with Jesus here, he chooses to use the word agape, right? And it's best defined as unconditional, selfless, sacrificial. That's the kind of love that Jesus is talking about here. How you love one another unconditionally, selflessly, sacrificially. See, this is the love that Jesus showed as he washed his disciples' feet, a task so lowly that the servants were asked to do it. This is the love which Jesus showed by going to the cross and dying for our sins. This is the love that Jesus would have for each and every person who he came in contact with. This is what makes this a new command, friends, because most people only love when they are loved. Most people only love when it benefits them or their needs. Even though it's forbidden by God to hate another person or to nurse a grudge or to seek vengeance, an eye for an eye, right? Or a tooth for a tooth was the rule of the day. Jesus calls us to love unconditionally, to love selflessly, to love sacrificially, while in the same way denying ourselves. Therefore, his words are a new command that we're to have. You know, there are several things here that we learn about loving others and how we extend love to others. The first is loving others is challenging. I mean, raise your hands in your house if love is challenging. No doubt about that, right? I mean, have you ever tried to make yourself love somebody? I mean, have you ever tried to force yourself to feel love? I mean, it's next to impossible to do that. Yet, Jesus commands us to love one another. A command is not just a suggestion or a request. A command is an order. Jesus says, you are to love one another. We need that force and authority behind us telling us to just do it, just to love one another. So Jesus commands us to love one another, but man, that's difficult. I don't know about you. I find it difficult sometimes to love some people. You know, there are a lot of people in this world who are just not very likable, much less lovable, right? I mean, the world is filled with mean, ugly, and hateful people. I mean, in my life, I have seen Christian men and women cut ties with fellow believers for no biblical reason at all. I have seen people tell their brothers and sisters in Christ to never contact them again. I have seen those who follow Jesus degrade and belittle other Christian followers. So, friends, and here's the tough word. We can say that we follow Jesus. We can say that we're disciples of him, but if we keep acting like the world and do not treat each other with the respect and dignity and honor in which God treats us, then we are not showing love to one another. We are not honoring the love that Jesus has shown to us. And even when we fall in love, it's difficult to maintain those warm feelings forever, isn't it? It's tough for us to love somebody all the time, right? Even when we fall in love with them. See, our tendency is that when the going gets tough in loving somebody, whether it's a friend or family or spouse or even a fellow believer, we give up, right? We throw our hands. It's too hard. It's too difficult. But Jesus commands us to love one another. In other words, do not give up. Just do it. Just love them. But see, that's not enough. How do we make ourselves feel love for somebody? That leads us to our second point. See, love is a response. See, Jesus goes on to say, in the same way that I loved you, you are to love one another. And in these words, the disciples are probably recalling the times that Jesus overwhelmingly loved them. He loved them when he called these disciples into training. He loved them by being their rabbi after they were told that they were not good enough and their childhood dream was a fantasy. He loved them when he came to them in the midst of the storm. He loved them when he forgave the disciples over who was fighting for the greatest seat in the kingdom of God, right? He loved them when he sent them all out to minister and heal. And even though they failed miserably, he built them back up and he loved them. He taught them. And he failed, and they failed time and time again. And patience and love that Jesus had showed them that he loved them when they failed to understand who Jesus was and even the extent of his power and knowledge, he continued to love and nurture them. When they rebuked Jesus because Jesus said he needed to go to the cross, he lovingly corrected them. When they tried to intervene when Jesus was being arrested, he looked on them with compassion of their lack of understanding. When they denied Jesus in his darkest hour and fell away from him, he reclaimed them and forgave them and loved them. And if all of that wasn't enough, on the cross, Jesus showed the depth and the breadth and the height of his love for them as he died on the cross. He loved them with a love that was overwhelming, never-ending, and powerful. So what is our response to this love? How should we react to the gift of grace that God has given to us? As we have been loved by Jesus, we in turn are to love one another. The original language in Greek says this: I have loved you in order that you may love one another, right? I have loved you in order that you may love one another. And it's a cause and effect dynamic here. Because we are loved by Jesus, we can love others. You know, Jesus' love for us is the cause for us to love one another. Jesus' love for us is the example on how we should love. And Jesus' love for us is the source upon which we should draw the power and the might, even with those unlovable people that we should love. We love one another, friends, because Jesus first loved us. This love that Jesus commands from us starts with him and flows from him beyond all of the people that we can love as well. Third, love isn't something that just happens to us. It's a choice. You hear people say, I just fell in love. Tweet, tweet, tweet. You know, they're all Twitter-pated, right? And if they just, it's like sometimes like they say, I just fell in love, like all of a sudden they just fell in a hole walking down the street. I mean, it's, no, you don't just fall in love. Love is not something that just happens to us. It's a choice that we make each and every day. We choose to love others. The problem is we're kind of selective in that process, aren't we? We love those who love us. We love others for what they do to us and do for us and how they make us feel. But Jesus' new command is to choose to love others, not some, but everyone. And that's easier said than done, isn't it? I mean, what about the guy who stands on the corner and he's kind of panhandling money for his next drink? Or what about the mother who I just read who puts a child in the dryer and turns it on? Or what about the man who strikes his wife out of anger? Would Jesus love these people just as much as he loves us, his people? Absolutely. Jesus came to save the poor. He came to save the sinners. He came to save the broken. Jesus loves you no more or less than anyone else, and that love goes against our very natural inclination. It's impossible for us to practice that kind of love alone. The only way that we can show that kind of love is with the help of God himself. If he helps us set aside our own desires and interests, then and only then can we give love without any expectations in return. And that's when we become more like Jesus, when we show unconditional love. It starts with the decision to love others and then turn to the source of that unconditional love, Jesus, who loves us unconditionally. Fourth, love is not a feeling, it's action. Love is usually thought of as something that we think about, right? In reality, it's a choice and it's action. In fact, in the New Testament, love is a noun 110 times and a verb 137. 247 times the word love is referenced. Now, parents, be honest. I want you to be honest. How many of you have done things for your children that you really didn't want to do? Now, I'm going to wait for you to raise your hand, even if your kids are there. You go ahead. Yeah. How many times have you driven carpool, fixed lunches, gone to soccer games or softball games or ballet or piano lessons, read goodnight stories, rubbed backs when you really didn't feel like it? I mean, of course you have. Of course there are times in which we do that. If we only did those things for each other when we felt like it, the chances are we wouldn't do a lot of things that would provide for a safe, loving environment we would want in our homes. Love is action, and sometimes it's without the warm and fuzzy feelings. Too often, we only love others when we feel like it. See, the key to choosing to love someone and to act lovingly is to love them even before you feel like it. Right, the key to choosing to love someone is to seek them out and to find ways in which you can serve them even before you feel like it. What sometimes I think we fail to realize is that our feelings, friend, follow action, and not just our actions doesn't own our feelings. So we need to act in love first, and then I truly believe the feelings will come. There's a newspaper columnist, George Crane, writes of a woman who was full of hatred. She just did not like her husband at all. And someone counseled her to say if she really loved her husband, to tell him how much he meant to her. to praise him and for every decent trait, to be kind and considerate and generous whenever possible. And then when she'd fully convinced him of her undying love, she would make the move and divorce him. That's what she said. And with revenge in her eyes, she said, that's perfect, I'm going to do it, right? And so she did, and she did, and she complimented him every day for a whole month, and she told him all of these things, that how great he was, and how wonderful the dinners were, and how appreciative she was that he mowed the lawn, and she did this, and guess what happened? See, the more and more she demonstrated sacrificial love to her husband, the more she began to love him and care for him, and at the end of those months, that idea of divorce was the last thing on her mind, because she fell back in love with him, because she demonstrated an unconditional sacrificial love, and it was something that she carried with her throughout her whole life. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 43 and 44, the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus told the crowd, you've heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy, but I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. See, the way you love your enemies is through your actions. Jesus didn't just teach it, he lived it. I mean, his interactions with those who hated him the most, Jesus loved them. He continued to love them when he was being crucified. He continued to love them even after the crowds had stoned him and mocked him and whipped him and spat upon him and screamed, crucify him. And as he hung on the cross, he prayed, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. I mean, that's our model for loving one another, and it starts with our actions, friends. Because when we do, our fifth kind of conversation this morning is that love will become our greatest witness. This is how everyone will know that you are my disciples, Jesus says, when they see how you love each other. Not when you see how you love the world, not when they see how you love your family, but when they see how you love your brothers and sisters in Christ. And that's the sign, that's the measure, that's the benchmark. And if people can look outside, from outside, can look through the windows of our church and say, wow, look at how they love each other, then they will always be attracted to that body, that community, that faith community. They would be attracted to the life of Christ. See, the church's life and the relationships to one another will be so dramatically different, far different than anything that they had ever experienced in the world. And it would be so attractive that all of those who do not know Jesus will be drawn into the body of Christ because they see how we treat each other, and they want to be treated that way as well, with respect and with dignity and with encouragement and with a sense of love that only Jesus can give us. This is the premise of Will Willimon and Stanley Auerwas in a book called Resident Aliens, where you and I are invited to be resident aliens on this earth, called to be and live differently from the world, and yet called to live in the world. This is a quote from their book. As resident aliens, we are called to offer an alternative way of life to this world, one that is so attractive to the world, it would be attracted to be living for Jesus. In other words, we are to be salt in a bland world, light in a world filled with darkness, to show the world there's a better way, and everyone will recognize that you are my disciples when they see the love that you have for each other. Friends, if we can't love one another, then we'll never be able to extend that love to others outside of the church. If we can't love those who Jesus has called us to be in community with, then friends, we will not be able to love those who Jesus is calling us to reach out to. The church has to become a place where we learn to love as Jesus loved, so that we can go into the world and love it in an extraordinary way. Chad Steenerson is a Birmingham cab driver, and Steenerson spent $700 of his own money to place a billboard in Indiana and a sign that reads, pray for McVeigh, right? He put his website address on the billboard too, and in a five-day period, he had 3,000 hits on his website. And Chad said, I've been getting lots of nasty emails. I mean, listen to his rationale for the billboard. See, if you believe Jesus died for everybody, that includes people who are doing very bad things, who we may not like. None of us deserves the grace anyways. God's grace is not dependent on human opinions of one another. Who are we to deny the possibility of God's grace to Timothy McVeigh? He gets it. Chris got Jesus' command correct. We love because Christ loves us. So where do we go from here? Well, the next time that you're engaging in your home, your faith community, and your world, remember that you are loved and that you are to love. And it's not a suggestion, it's a command. Jesus tells us we are to love one another. Love others unconditionally. Love others through your actions. Love others first and allow them to receive the power of that love that you received from the author of love, Jesus the Christ. Let's pray together. Holy and gracious God, we do thank you for this time. And we thank you, Lord God, for your love and your hope and your grace and your power and your purpose. God, we pray that as we continue to love and as we continue to hear your voice in our lives, that God, everything that you are permeates in us and then permeates through us, that we might radiate that wonderful power of your Son, Jesus. And that God, because you first loved us, we are to love one another. Because you first loved us unconditionally, that you first loved us selflessly, that you first loved us sacrificially, Lord God, that because of all of that, we know that we can love others. So God, as we go through this series over the next couple of months and we talk about what it means to be with one another as a body of faith, how we do these things as we confess to one another and pray for one another and hold each other accountable and to disciple each other, God, may we remember this first message that we are to love one another. Everything we say and everything we do should permeate that love for you, which is found in Christ Jesus. So walk with us, God, now as we continue to shower love on all whom we meet, and as we teach others what love means by how we love each other. For we pray these things and we proclaim them in the name of the one who gives us life and hope, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
I see his body breaking. I see his fingers bleed. I see the darkness tremble at the ground below his feet. And in the darkest hour, there on Calvary, he was sweetly broken, broken beautifully, broken beautifully. So come out into the waters, come let the broken sing, come all you sons and daughters. His love changes everything. Come when the fear is fighting, you're finding the risen King. Come on and let the light in. Your love changes everything. And when the heavens open, I saw the sea. Crown of glory as you died. And I will fear no evil. And you'll never let me go. You'll never let me go.
God, your love changes everything. What a powerful word we've been given today. Love is challenging. Love is a response. Love is a choice. Love is action. And love is our greatest witness. Wow. John 13, 34 and 35, our verse for today. A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. We go with that word in our hearts. We go with that in our spirit. We go with that as a driving force for who we are as Christ's disciples. And as you live your life out there in your communities, out there in your neighborhoods, in your homes, with your families, that's our command, is to love one another. What a wonderful day it's been to worship together with you. We're so glad that we could have this opportunity to join by spirit and join as one body of Christ, to celebrate his love together, celebrate his faithfulness. We are so grateful. Please be aware of all the other opportunities that we have during the week to stay connected. Children, there's so many great opportunities through Kidmin and through Michelle to connect for games and for story time throughout our week. So please be aware of those things. Don't forget we have prayer and praise time together as a community on Wednesday nights. Look to our Facebook page for all of that information as we stay connected as the body of Christ and as we love one another. Have a wonderful day. We'll see you again next time. God bless.